Your Eminence, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. I am Krisa Lamrinakou, the Vice President of the Macedonian Society of Great Britain. On behalf of the Executive Committee, I would like to welcome you tonight. The Macedonian Society was founded in 1989 with the aim of promoting the Macedonian history and culture, and it is the main organization in the UK that informs, educates, that informs and educates the public about Macedonia, its history, its heritage. Today, the Macedonian Society is a modern society that has a group of dedicated people willing to work hard to promote not only Macedonia, but Greece in general. The Executive Committee and me personally would like to thank the Levedis Foundation for their invaluable support over the years, which allows us to continue our work. Also, we are particularly grateful to Levedis Foundation for the sponsorship of tonight's event. Without their support, this function could not have taken place. Also, we would like to thank Hellenic TV and Live Media Greece for offering to cover this event. We would like to thank the Friends of Mt Athos and especially Dr. Graham Speake for his help and advice. Also, we would like to thank our panelists for taking part in this event. Special thanks to Dr. Talbot, who traveled from the USA, and Mr. Rigopoulos, who traveled from Greece. The future of the Society depends mainly on donations and memberships from our members and friends. As you know, we are a registered charity, and all our events are open to the public. So your support, either by donations or membership, will give us the tools to organize events like this one in the future. Our next event is on the 15th of December, a very prestigious Christmas ball held at the five-star Royal Garden Hotel with live music, excellent food, and Christmas atmosphere.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. Actually, evening. I'm going to speak about our panelists today, and a great warm welcome to all of you who have made it here. I'm going to start talking about each one's achievements in life up to this point and the topics they've talked to before, according to the order they're going to speak. First, Graham Speake. Graham Speake is the founder and chairman of the Friends of Mt Athos. He is a regular visitor to the Holy Mountain and was received into Orthodoxy there in 1999. Trained as a classicist, he holds degrees from both Cambridge and Oxford and is a fellow of the Society of Antiquaries. He's the author of two books about Mt Athos. Mt Athos, first, Mt Athos, Renewal in Paradise, which won the 2002 Critics Prize, and its sequel, A History of the Athenite Commonwealth, the Spiritual and Cultural Diaspora of Mt Athos. Secondly, Konstantinos Rigopoulos, who was graduated from Oxford Brookes University in Oxford with a Bachelor of Architecture degree. He received his diploma degree from the School of Architecture of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki in Greece. He holds a Master of Science in Protection, Conservation and Restoration of Cultural Monuments from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. Since 2007, he has been working at the Center of the Preservation of the Athenite Heritage, KEDAC. His responsibilities are related to projects concerning restoration of the monuments of Mt Athos. And he has been recently appointed as deputy head in the Department of the Monument Conservation and restoration projects. Thirdly, Alice Mary Talbot, the only lady of our panel today. Dr. Alice Mary Talbot is a historian and has spent most of her career at Dumbarton Oaks, a research institute at Harvard University located in Washington, D.C. She served as an executive editor of the Oxford Dictionary of Byzantium and for 12 years as director of Byzantine Studies. Her scholarly interests have focused on monasticism, hagiography, and women's studies. Her recent books include The Life of St. Basil the Younger and The Holy Men of Mt Athos, a volume entitled Varieties of Monastic Experience in Byzantium between 800 and 1453, is currently in press at the University of Notre Dame. Fourthly, Douglas Dales is the Associate Anglican Priest in the East Downland Benefice in the Diocese of Oxford. For many years, he was chaplain of Marlborough College. Married with three grown-up children, he has now written a number of books of early medieval history and also theology. He is a regular visitor of the Holy Mount, of the Holy Mountain, Mount Athos, which he visits each year for retreats at Letin Vatopedi and Simonopetra. In addition, his wife and he have both a strong friendship with the Orthodox monastery here in Essex, in England. And last but not least, Kallistos Ware, Metropolitan Kallistos of Diokleia, holds a doctorate in theology from the University of Oxford, where from 1966 to 2001, he was a fellow at Pembroke College and Spalding lecturer in Eastern Orthodox studies. He's a monk of the monastery of St. John the Theologian in Patmos and an assistant bishop in the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese of Thyatira and Great Britain. His publications include The Orthodox Church, third edition in 2015, and The Orthodox Way. And he is the president of the Friends of Mount Athos. Firstly, I must now introduce Dr. Graham Speake to start. He will give us a talk about the ecumenical nature of Athos, a historical perspective. Please, you can.
17 years have passed since I last addressed your society on the subject of Mount Athos. I had then visited the mountain 10 times and been baptized there. I've now visited a further 9 times and published 2 books about its history. Display copies are available at the back for anyone who's interested in them. The mountain has become my spiritual home. And like a swallow in the spring, I go back there as often as I can. This evening, I was asked to talk to you about the history of Mount Athos. But in fact, I'm going to speak about the pan-orthodoxy of the mountain. For me, it's the pan-orthodoxy of Athos that is the jewel in its crown, and it has been so throughout its history. Athos is in Macedonia, and Macedonia, as everyone here would agree, is in Greece. But Athos is not Greek. Athos is the spiritual heart of the entire Orthodox world. And if it were ever to lose its pan-orthodoxy, it would lose the greater part of its raison d'etre. Anyone who's been there, or anyone who has had the pleasure of sailing round the peninsula, which anyone can do, will agree that it is pretty inhospitable territory. The further south you go down its coast, the rockier it gets, until at the southern tip, the mountain itself suddenly springs up out of the sea to a height of just over 2,000 meters. It's ideal country for the ascetic life. The first hermits came in the 9th century. They lived in caves or built themselves rudimentary huts, often overlooking the sea, like these at Carulia. Some of them are still there. They live amazingly austere lives, devoting themselves to prayer and scratching a meager diet from the infertile soil. Not all the hermits live in such vertiginous locations. This is a cell probably inhabited by a small group of monks in rather pleasing countryside, with its own olive grove at the foot of the mountain itself. Many monks still live in situations like this. They don't all live in the monasteries. Around the year 960, Saint Athanasius the Athenite came to the mountain. He was a native of Trebizond on the Black Sea coast of Asia Minor, and he came first as a hermit. But he was a charismatic character and was already a friend of Nikephoros Phokas, the future emperor, who wanted his company on an expedition to liberate Crete from Arab pirates. Athanasius agreed to go, and Crete was duly recovered for the empire. And on the strength of their Cretan spoils, the two men planned to found a monastery, and Nikephoros agreed to become a monk. Athanasius returned to Athos and started to build. But instead of a collection of cells of the sort that already existed on the mountain, what he built was this, the Great Lavra, a massive cenobitic monastery, a bit like the Studios Monastery in Constantinople. Inside, a protecting circuit of high walls. Nothing of the sort had ever existed on Athos before. He equipped the monastery with a splendid church, which still stands. The church was completed in the year 963, and that date has been associated ever since with the foundation of the monastery. So, for example, it was in 1963 that celebrations were held for the millennium of Athos. Also in that year, 963, Nikephoros was crowned emperor, thus breaking his agreement to become a monk. But he continued to support the monastery with gifts, not only of money, but of relics and a generous annuity to secure its future. Athanasios also built a refectory for his brotherhood, which is behind this painted facade, and still contains its original marble-topped tables. Now, with a church and a refectory, the fathers had somewhere to worship together and somewhere to eat together, which gave them the basic facilities for a cenobitic or common lifestyle. The monastery flourished, and by the end of the decade, the 960s, that is, it had a brotherhood of 120 monks. Athanasios remained as abbot for nearly 40 years, during which time he acquired fame not only for his piety and his learning, but also his qualities as a ruler and pastor, a reputation that attracted monks from all over Eastern Europe and even further afield, from Georgia and Armenia in the east and from Italy in the west. During Athanasios' lifetime, numerous other monasteries were founded on Athos. Not all of them survive, but of those that do, this one needs to be mentioned. This is Iveron, the monastery of the Georgians. Georgia was an independent kingdom outside the Byzantine Empire, but links between the two were close. And a group of Georgian monks had found their way to Athos and become disciples of Athanasios. In return for services to the emperor in war, the Georgians were granted generous sums of money, as well as land on Athos, suitable for the foundation of a monastery. And this is the result. The monastery was equipped with a large church, which stands in the middle of the courtyard, and a refectory. This is not the original one, of course, as well as a library, which still houses one of the richest collections on the mountain today. and the monastery soon became an important center for the copying of manuscripts and for cultural exchange between Byzantium and Georgia. This lonely tower is all that remains of another remarkable institution on the mountain that came from outside the borders of the empire. This was the Benedictine monastery of the Amalfitans, founded before the end of the 10th century by monks from the city of Amalfi on the west coast of Italy. They were first drawn to the mountain by the charismatic reputation of Saint Athanasius, who welcomed them, though it was in fact the Georgians who helped them to found their own monastery in about 985. And it's a tribute to the ecumenical nature of Athenite monasticism at the time that this monastery survived for more than 300 years. One could scarcely credit the existence of a Benedictine house using a Latin rite on Athos today. So far, we've had Georgians arriving from the east and Italians from the west. Now, by the start of the 11th century, we have evidence of Russians arriving from the north. Their country had only recently received Christianity with the baptism of Prince Vladimir of Kiev in 988. Yet by 1016, there is already a record of a Russian presence on Athos. And this is where it was. It's still a Russian house today, the Skete of Bogorodica, but it stands on the site of the former monastery of Xilurgu, which means of the carpenter. Here is its church, which dates from the early 11th century and is dedicated to the Dormition of the Mother of God. By 1169, the Russian Brotherhood had grown substantially and needed a larger site, which was duly found for them, and the ruined monastery of St. Pantelimon was given to them with permission to rebuild it. Only one or two monks live there today, because in 1765, most of the Russians moved to a new site by the sea, where they remain to this day. Meanwhile, the peoples of Eastern Europe, even if they remained politically independent of the Byzantine Empire, all owed their religion and much of their culture to Byzantium. They shared common cultural values, and they formed an unofficial community which we now know as the Byzantine Commonwealth. They all looked to Constantinople for ecclesiastical authority, and as Athos emerged as the international center of Byzantine spirituality, they looked to the mountain as the monastic focus, where they all aspired to have a place of their own. Thus they formed a new spiritual and cultural community, which I have named the Athenite Commonwealth. Next on the scene were the Serbs, who took advantage of the growing weakness of the empire in the late 12th century and cultivated cultural relations with their Byzantine neighbors. In 1193, a prince of the Serbian ruling family became a monk on Athos with the name Savas. 3 years later, his father abdicated and joined his son on Athos with the name Simeon. And in 1198, the two of them, Savas and Simeon, were granted ownership of a derelict Greek monastery, and together they founded the new cenobitic monastery of Hilandar, which you see here. With support from Serbia, as well as from the emperor, the monastery flourished, and by 1204 it had 90 monks. It was equipped with the usual requirements for a cenobitic monastery, such as this beautiful church, which was actually rebuilt in the 14th century. And the church contains the famous Trikerosa, or three-handed icon of the Mother of God. And of course, a refectory, whose walls are decorated with fine frescoes of the saints. Hilandar Monastery is much loved by the Serbs and holds a central place in Serbian cultural memory. St. Savas is the country's patron saint, and you see him wherever you go. Bulgarians had probably been on Athos from the 10th century, but the monastery of Zografu, which is their monastery today, seems not to have become Bulgarian before the 13th century. Its port tower, shown here, dates probably from the late 15th century. The monastery itself lies a few kilometers inland and is surrounded by dense forest. And its massive church dates from the start of the 19th century and is dedicated to St. George. The Romanians were not organized ecclesiastically before the 14th century, when the metropolitanates of Moldavia and Wallachia declared their allegiance to Constantinople. The Greek monastery of Kutlumusiu, seen here, was an earlier foundation, but by the 14th century it had become very dilapidated, and its abbot sent a plea to the rulers of Wallachia for assistance. They undertook to rebuild it, and in return, Romanian monks were admitted to the monastery, which for a while was known as the Lavra of Wallachia. But in fact, it never ceased to be a Greek monastery, and the Romanians have never actually held a monastery of their own on Athos. But they do possess a number of subsidiary settlements, such as the cells of Kolitsou near Vatopedi, which you see in this picture, where the celebrated blind elder Dionysios lived until his death at the age of 96 in 2004. Also Romanian is the skete of Prodromu, which is a dependency of Great Lavra. This skete has seen revival recently, thanks largely to the inspired leadership of Prior Petrenios, and numbers have risen to about 50. Similarly revived is the other Romanian skete of Lacu, which nestles below the peak of the mountain itself and is a dependency of St. Paul's Monastery. Here, the revival has been led by Prior Stefan, seen here in a photograph taken 20 years ago. As at Prodromu, numbers here have also risen to about 50. They were down to one in the 1970s. In the 19th century, there was a dramatic expansion of the Russian presence on the mountain, as is demonstrated by this picture of St. Andrew's Skete. It housed nearly 1,000 monks at its height, and in the first decade of the 20th century, Slavs were actually in a majority on Athos, outnumbering Greeks. But then the bubble burst. They were split by heresy, and half of them were deported. Then they suffered revolution and civil war. And after 1917, no more Russians came to the mountain, either as monks or as pilgrims. And the monks on Athos gradually got older and older and fewer, until the last monk at this skete died in the 1970s. Two of the Russian skeets were Hellenized in the 1990s, including this one. But the Russian monastery of St. Pandelimonos has now seen considerable revival and has a brotherhood of about 100 monks. In 1912, Athos was finally liberated from the Ottoman Empire, And here is the Holy Epistasia, our governing body of the mountain, for that year, proudly guarded for the first time by Greek Evzones. Athos continued to produce holy men throughout the 20th century, and still does so today. Here, for example, is the celebrated hermit of Karulia, the Russian Father Nikon, who died in 1963. Now, this is a brand new fresco at Kolitsou, which I saw for the first time this year, and which shows some of the greatest new saints of Athos. From the left, you see portrayed, first of all, Saint Silouan, the great Russian elder who's revered throughout Russia today. Then Saint Porphyrios of Kafsakolivia, famous for his gifts of spiritual discernment, who was canonized as recently as 2013. Then Saint Paisios, who was canonized by the Ecumenical Patriarchate only 3 years ago, and whose icon you see everywhere in Greece today. And then St. Gideon of Karakalou, the new martyr. That's a brand new fresco just put up in the Romanian cells at Kolitsou. This is Elder Joseph the Hesychast, who lived in a remote cell in the Athenite desert, and who is regarded as one of the chief architects of the revival that took place on Athos in the second half of the 20th century. This is the cell where he lived. His disciples went out from there to revive no fewer than 6 Athenite monasteries. One of them was Elder Joseph of Vatopedi, seen here on the left of this photo, while his spiritual child, Abbot Ephrem of Vatopedi, on the right, tonsures a new monk. And now we come full circle. As I said earlier, the Georgians were among the first to acquire a monastery of their own on Athos in the 10th century, though they lost control of it in the 14th century. But recently, Georgian monks have been returning to the mountain. And here we see new cells being built by the monastery of Vatopedi specifically to accommodate Georgian monks. And here in my last picture is Patriarch Kirill of Moscow visiting the Serbian monastery of Hilandar in 2013. There is no question that the Russians are back. The Pan-Orthodoxy of Athos is as vibrant as ever, and Athos remains the spiritual heart of the entire Orthodox world. Thank you.
Good evening. First of all, I would like to thank the Macedonian Society of Great Britain and especially the President, Ms. Venturi, for the invitation to give this lecture. It is an honor for me, and I really enjoy being among you tonight. I hope at the end the whole presentation meets your expectations. The origin of the Athonite heritage is dating back to the Byzantine Empire. The emperors, the emperors and other influential persons of the empire aided in every possible way the holy mountain in order to develop a great architecture which would reflect the glory of the Byzantium. The financial capacity, the geomorphic conditions of the area, and the need for protection from the pirate raids during medieval times resulted in the creation of a large building projects based on the principles of Byzantine fortress architecture. So the high walls that surround each monastery, except that they are a real fortress with turrets, battlements, and defensive towers, at the same time they symbolize the limits of the monastic community from the outside world. The isolation and absence of secular life has obliged each monastery to become as much as possible a self-sufficient production unit. The original form of the Athonite monastery has been therefore a combination of a Byzantine fortress on the outside and a set of urban-type buildings focused on the Catholicon on the inside. The settlement of Mount Athos are classified in the following categories. There are 20 monasteries. Each one is a large fortress-like building complex with its building arranged in a perimeter around the courtyard whose center is occupied by the large church, the Catholicon. In addition to the ruling monasteries, there are many other smaller settlements. There are 12 skites. The four cenobitic skites set up just like the monasteries, that is, as a closure of monasteries. They are smaller, poorer, and more ascetic compared to their parent house, but their organization is very similar to that of monasteries. The eight idiorhythmic skites are more loosely structured, having the form of a cluster settlement of houses, known as kalives, which are scattered around the main common church, the so-called Kyriakon. Cells or kelia represent the smallest organized monastic establishments. They are independent buildings scattered around the cliffs and valleys of the mountain. They have living quarters and an attached chapel. They are generally occupied either by a single monk or by a small group of monks. Kalives and kathismata are like the kelia, but usually smaller. Finally, in remote and inaccessible locations, there are hermitages, simple huts, shelters, and more often, just caves in the cliffs. It is easily perceived that the way people are living in a region, as well as the available local building materials, have great influence on the architecture of that region. This effect becomes even greater if the way of life of the inhabitants is quite special compared to those found in the rest of society, just as it happens in the Holy Mountain. It is necessary to explain briefly the two different ways of monastic life we meet on Mount Athos. Today, the classic cenobitic type is applied in all 20 monasteries of Mount Athos. According to it, the life in the commune is developed within the limits of the enclosure of the monastery and is based on the common daily schedule of the monks. In the context of the cenobitic type, there are included common program of services and prayer, common dining, and distribution of various obediences and jobs. The diorhythmic type had spread during the Ottoman rule in several monasteries. In the diorhythmic type, each monk is financially dependent and responsible for himself. He has a private space not only for his personal accommodation, but also for the preparation of the daily food, with private dining room and kitchen, as well as guest rooms. Today, this type has become extinct in the monasteries, but kept on the eight diorhythmic skites. It becomes obvious that different types of monastic life lead to different architectural solutions. The most important of Mount Athos settlements are, with no doubt, the 20 monasteries. The organization of the Athonite monastery is based on the model of the ancient fortified town. It consists of a rectangular fortified enclosure surrounding a central court in which the main church, the Catholicon, forms the center of the composition. Around it, inside the court, various chapels and other buildings are scattered where space allows. The refectory or trapeza is placed opposite the Catholicon. The entrances of the two buildings are closely related, stressing the processional link. The perimeter houses communal facilities like storehouses, offices, working areas, and the monk's accommodation, as well as the guest house and the hospital. Defenses provided by making the inside of the court the main facade, avoiding outside window on lower levels and piercing the enclosure with a single strongly defended gate and passage. The fortification of the religious establishments and several isolated locations on Holy Mountain is an issue that is at first glance alien to the spiritual character of the place. However, it should be considered the fact that Athonite monasteries were constituted at very difficult times. The defensive character of the monastery enclosure is more apparent in the oldest surviving parts of precincts, such as in the western part of the southern side of the Great Lavra. In the newer parts, the improvement of security conditions is expressed with the increase of windows in number and size, the creation of closed and open balconies, and the care for more organization of the facades. Nevertheless, the main spatial characteristics of the settlement, recognized in the relationship of its major structural elements, the enclosure wall, the church, and the refectory, remain constant. This continuity of elements was connected to the prescribed daily routine of the monastic life, which didn't change for centuries. This formal model is followed to the extent the topography allows. In case where horizontal expansion is problematic, the monastery expands in height with the addition of floors, often gaining a strong visual appearance. The evolutionary process, although accepting external influences and local attitudes from the neighboring mainland, maintained its strict traditions and always aimed to achieve its own objectives. In this way, Athonite architecture never lost its appeal towards the monks and remained direct towards their way of life. It aimed to fulfill the practical and spiritual aspects in their life. In this context, the element of the accidental is to be anticipated, if not forgiven, taking its place in the architectural development of the monasteries. The most important building of the monastery of Mount Athos is without doubt the main church, the so-called Catholicon. The Catholicon stands usually where space allows, free in the middle of the court, expressing in this way the sovereign role as center of the life of the monastery. The typology of Mount Athos Catholica belongs to the so-called Athonite type of church, which is basically the composite of cruciform type, cross and square plan, with the addition of two lateral niches of the choirs. All have the basic parts of church, narthex, naos, and sanctuary. The distinctive difference from the Byzantine church elsewhere are the spacious, usually column support narthex, the so-called liti, and second, the chapels that are sometimes at the end of the liti. To the west of the liti, there is the arcade with open or closed arches in the facade, while sometimes between this and the liti, there is another narthex, the exonarthex, which is narrower than the liti with simpler roof. Kyriakon. The architecture of the Kyriakon, that is the central church of the skiti, follows in general lines the features of the architecture of Catholicon. Though it is Athonite type church, it is less conservative in style and simpler in form. The masonry is plainer and the proportions of the apses and the domes are heavier than in the Catholica. From the general rule should be excluded the Kyriaka, which were built after the mid-19th century in Cenobitic skites with a foreign monastic brotherhood, for example, in skiti of St. Andrew in Karges, which reflect the characteristics of Eastern European church architecture of the era. The chapels are a particularly large group of buildings on Mount Athos. Sometimes they are separate buildings, and other times part of larger building complexes, Catholica, monastic wings, towers, cells, boathouses, etc. From a typological point of view, the majority of chapels belongs to a compact cross-register type. In this type, the columns are attached to the side walls as pilasters, so that the whole space of the nave to be covered by a dome, usually without a drum. The refectory or trapeza is the most important building after the Catholicon in the monasteries of Mount Athos. The monks go there in procession after the end of divine liturgy. It is logical, therefore, that it should be located in the immediate vicinity of the Catholicon, so that the distance between the entrances to be the smallest possible. When the area of the monastery allows it, the refectory is an independent building, like in Great Lavra and Vatopedi. Otherwise, as it usually happens, the refectory is part of the wing which is the most most close to the Catholicon. The interior walls of refectories are decorated with religious images, stressing the sacred character of the building. The older ones having solid built tables, and the later ones long wooden tables. The architectural shape of the building is closely related to its function. It is a long rectangular hall, usually with an apse on its shorter side. At that end, usually, is the niche with the abbot's table. The fiali is used for the ceremony of the blessing of the waters. The fiales are the most elegant architectural elements of the Athonite monasteries. These are small circular buildings covered with a mud brick hemispherical dome, which is supported through brick built also arch by 8 marble pillars. They are usually found west of the Catholicon. Not all the monasteries have one. Where there is insufficient space, open space, there is no fiali. The buildings of the wings, intended for the installation of the monastic community, they include areas that accommodate various needs of the monastery, integrating often buildings with special functions, for example, the refectory or the kitchen, wherever there is not enough space. In these cases, the Catholica and the fiales are the only buildings that usually remain independent. The ground floor and the basement are usually used for the storage of various supplies, food, wine, oil, etc., while the other floors are occupied by spaces of permanent residence, rooms for monks, nursing homes, hospitals, places of administrative functions, offices, synodicon, abbess, as well as space for the reception and the guest rooms. Depending on the needs of its specific use, there are also corresponding auxiliary spaces, kitchens, lavatories, etc., and of course, chapels. The typology and the structure of the buildings of the wings have not changed substantially through the centuries. The construction consists of two main longitudinal walls. Depending on the specific layout of the rooms, on the upper floors, the access is usually achieved either through successive galleries that occupy the side of the building towards the courtyard, or through internal corridors along the central axis. Regarding to the form of the wings, the outer facades of the oldest examples of the early Ottoman rule were solid and immutable, with a strongly fortified character, with little or no decoration, and without special care about morphology. The symmetrically placed windows of different sizes are the result of subsequent improvisations. Until the 17th century, the facades of the wings towards the courtyard are formed in successive continuous rows of wooden balconies alleged on pillars or wooden columns. By mid-century, the facades of the successive brick arches and the walls of rubble masonry with brick decoration begin to dominate. During the 18th century, the application of the galleries with arcades generalized and the brick decorative masonry got enriched. From the beginning of the 19th century, gradually the facades of the fully built arcades with the blind arches seem to prevail. In these cases, there are rows of rooms on both sides of the buildings, and instead of rubble masonry, there used to have been built walls with same-hewn stones and bricks. After the 19th century, the use of purely same-hewn or fully chamber masonry expands and begins to show influences from the sophisticated architecture of the time, while there are some influences of classicism in individual elements of the buildings. The defensive character of the Pain-Athonite establishments makes the tower an essential element of their architecture. Built at the highest or the weakest point of the monastery, they served as observation posts against pirate raids and as the monks' last refuge when the rest of the monastery had been occupied by pirates or brigands. Observation towers were also built over a number of the monastery's boat houses. Towers are buildings of square plan, constructed with a rubble masonry. They have a staircase inside, a chapel at the top, and embrasures or machicolations all around. The walls of the lower floors are shaped for safety reasons with no openings, but on the upper floors there are few small openings. On the ground floor there are water tanks and storage spaces, while on the upper floors space for the accommodation of the people residing there. On the highest level there are built narrow, closed balconies with machicolations in the floor to assist in the defense against the besiegers. These elements, in combination with the necessary battlements at the top of the walls, give the otherwise heavy and without decoration towers a sense of variety and some morphological interest. From the early days of monasticism on Mount Athos, the sea formed the primary means of communication, both with the outside world as well as within the community due to the mountainous interior of the peninsula and the absence of infrastructure discouraging land travel. Each monastery possessed then, as it still does today, its own boat, which has been used for transport, fishing, and trade purposes. The importance of sea travel, as well as the need for protection against pirate raids, materialized in the buildings of boat houses or arsenas. As a result, the characteristic type of boat house found on Athos is the defended boat house, which combines the boat store and storage bay area with a defense tower housing the caretaker's accommodation. The boat store consists of an elongated space with a large arched entrance, which is always open at the narrow side towards the sea, so that it is easy to lift or launch the boats to and from the interior. The towers of the boat houses provide the first line of defense against pirate raids scattered on the coasts of Athos. Today, Mount Athos faces the challenge of adapting itself to modern technologies without losing its traditional character. As far as architecture is concerned, this balance is not always easy. More young monks have a renovating spirit and are bent on leading a less retiring life. As a result, just next to humble traditional cells, big and modern buildings erect in order to accommodate and serve modern needs and amenities. The authority for restoration work in Athonite architecture belongs to the Center for the Preservation of Mount Athos Heritage, KEDAC. Among the key principles of restoration is that a human work is a carrier of memory. The aim of the restorer is to safeguard the memories of human generation as they are imprinted in the passage of time over the bodies of monuments. Our everyday effort at KEDAC is to achieve a balance between tradition and the contemporary demands of modern monastic life. Thank you very much for your attention.
My topic this evening is women and Mount Athos in the Byzantine period. And I emphasize the conjunction and, women and Mount Athos, not women on Mount Athos. As most of you are aware, it would in fact be impossible for me to talk about women on Athos, since for many centuries they have been forbidden to set foot on the holy mountain. This is a result of the tradition of Avaton, the principle that women are denied access to Athos. The practice seems to have been in force since the 9th century, when hermits first arrived on the deserted peninsula and began to turn it into a center of Orthodox monasticism. The prohibition of the presence of women on Athos represents an extension of the traditional monastic rule of Avaton, observed with different degrees of rigor at different institutions, that prohibited men and women from entering a monastery housing monastics of the opposite sex. In the case of Athos, the mountain came to be regarded as one large monastic complex, and hence it seemed proper to impose a total prohibition on women. Justification for the practice was found in legendary traditions of uncertain date to the effect that Christ had granted Athos to his mother, the Virgin Mary, and thus the peninsula became off limits to all other women. Another legendary tale recounted that when the 5th century Empress Galla Placidia visited the Vatopedi Monastery, and this would have been a chronological impossibility since it was not founded until the 10th century, a voice came from an icon of the Virgin ordering her to leave and stating that only one queen, the Virgin, was allowed on Athos and no other woman was permitted to set foot on the peninsula. It should be emphasized that the ban on women on Athos was an unwritten rule. No legislation or monastic rule of the Byzantine era explicitly excludes women from the Holy Mountain, although such an exclusion is implied in some of the regulatory documents. The 10th century rule of St. Athanasius for the Great Lavra, for example, states, and I quote, "You will not own any animal of the female sex for the purpose of doing any work which you require, because you have absolutely renounced all female beings," end quote. No later Byzantine legislation contains a more specific prohibition on women. It seems that the principle of Avaton was so ingrained in Athenite custom law and tradition that it was unnecessary to put such a rule in writing. And in fact, the traditional prohibition sufficed. During the Byzantine era, that is up to 1453, I know of only 3 instances when women visited the peninsula. Around 1100, several hundred families of nomadic Vlach herders moved onto Athos to pasture their flocks of sheep and goats. Not only did Vlach girls work as shepherdesses, but they brought cheese, milk, and wool to the monasteries and baked bread for the monks. Shortly thereafter, the patriarch in Constantinople learned of the scandal and expelled the Vlach shepherd families. In 1308, at a time of crop failure, at least 2 families from Hierissos, which is a town on the frontier with Athos, sought refuge at the monastery of Vatopedi because of famine and their fear of attack by the Catalan Grand Company. As a final instance, during the winter of 1347-48, Jelena, the wife of the Serbian Tsar Stefan Dušan, spent several months at the Serbian monastery of Hilandar in an apparent attempt to flee the Black Death. In this case, the monks were in no position to deny hospitality to Stefan and his wife, since the Tsar had recently conquered the Chalkidiki Peninsula and had subjugated Athos under his control. My own scholarly research on investigating the relations of women with the Holy Mountain began almost 25 years ago on the occasion of a symposium on Mount Athos organized by Bishop Kallistos and Professor Anthony Breyer at the University of Birmingham. When Tony Breyer invited me to give a paper on the subject of women and Mount Athos, I at first protested that it was an impossible topic. But he encouraged me to accept the challenge, saying, "Look into it. I'm confident you'll find something." And he was right, for unexpectedly, the rich archives of the Athenite monasteries, which have been slowly but steadily edited over the past decades by teams of Greek and French scholars, turned out to contain quite a bit of information. This is not working. Okay, there it is. About female vendors and donors to Athenite institutions. Although women could not visit Mount Athos, monks could leave the Holy Mountain on business trips, during which they inspected the monastery's far-flung properties. And here I show you a map shows you a few of the locations where Athenite monastic properties were located, just to show you how far afield from the Holy Mountain these were. The properties included fields, vineyards, olive groves, water mills, and salt pans in the countryside, and houses, workshops, stores, and gardens in cities. In addition to overseeing these varied parcels of real estate, the monks were always seeking to add even more properties, and they often negotiated face-to-face with women, especially with widows, who had inherited substantial amounts of land and other immovable assets upon their husband's death and regained control of their own dowries. I have calculated that women were involved in 43% of all property transactions recorded in the Athenite Acts published to date, 27% in concert with their husbands or other male relatives, and 16% women acting on their own behalf. Not all the sales were completely voluntary, for sometimes monasteries exerted pressure on men and women alike to sell land that was adjacent to lands already owned by the monastery, so as to make up a contiguous parcel. On other occasions, monasteries used their economic might to force agreements with women in financial distress. In essence, the monasteries, with their large monetary reserves, were serving as banking institutions, which were a ready source of money for families that were cash poor. Thus, we read about a woman who sold a field to the Aviron Monastery in order to acquire the funds to ransom her son, who had been captured by the Arabs. Another woman was forced to sell land from her dowry because the family had suffered from a series of crop failures and was unable to support itself. The monasteries might offer a loan, with houses serving as collateral. If the loan was not repaid within the agreed period of time, the monastery took possession of the houses. Monasteries were also viewed as a safe repository of funds. A woman who sold property to the Hilandara Monastery, for example, asked that the monastery hold on to half the sale price until such time as she needed the cash for her daughter's dowry. A second principal category of transactions involving women was acts of donation. They, in turn, can be divided into two groups: donations in exchange for an annuity, and donations in exchange for prayers or commemoration. A so-called adelphaton, or fellowship, was a type of annuity which monasteries granted to generous donors, normally involving the provision of foodstuffs for life. For example, a widow might make an agreement with an Athenite monastery to receive for the rest of her life an annual allotment of wheat, dried legumes, cheese, wine, and olive oil in exchange for a gift of money or land. Much more common, however, was the donation of property to Athenite monasteries in exchange for spiritual benefits, the prayers of the monks for the salvation of one's soul, or for the posthumous commemoration of the donor or family members. A prime example is an elderly woman named Nymphodora, who lived in a village near the border of Mount Athos and had become a nun after her husband left her to take monastic vows at the Xeropotamu Monastery. Nymphodora was much dismayed that she too could not enter a monastery on the holy mountain, although she acknowledged that Athos was not accessible to any woman except for the Virgin. Despite her disappointment, in her will, she expressed her spiritual yearning by donating some properties to Xeropotamu, including a church, two monastic cells, and a wine cellar with all their contents. Her other legacies included a vineyard, a garden and orchard, two houses, and two large mechanical wheels, evidently lifting devices used in iron mining operations. She made this major bequest in exchange for the monk's promise to offer a prayer to the Virgin on her behalf at Vespers every Monday, to say the liturgy in her honor on Tuesdays, to drink a cup of wine in the refectory on her behalf, and to provide her with an annuity for the rest of her life. After she died, a liturgy was to be celebrated annually on the anniversary of her death for, quote, as long as Orthodoxy continues to hold sway on the holy mountain of Athos, to quote the words of her will. One of the most important surviving documents about women's pious donations is another will, the late 11th century testament of Kallipakuriani, which you see on the screen. She was the childless young widow of an aristocratic general who lived in Constantinople. And I should note parenthetically that these two women's wills, the only such documents preserved from the Byzantine era, have survived thanks to the fact that a copy was deposited in the archives of an Athenite monastery. Kali's husband had developed strong spiritual ties with the Iviron Monastery on Athos during his lifetime and made arrangements for his burial there in a marble sarcophagus. One of the bequests in his will was payment to the monastery for his funeral and burial expenses and subsequent commemoration. Once widowed and herself in failing health, Kali became the nun Maria and seems to have established a kind of household convent in her mansion in the capital, where she lived together with her mother, sister, a couple of friends, and some servants who also took the veil. Kali Maria, who had inherited the bulk of her husband's estate, gave Iviron property near present-day Drama to ensure the perpetual commemoration of her husband. The revenues from the estate were to provide sufficient income for the annual services, specifically 100 bushels of wheat, 10 sheep, and 100 measures of wine to cover the expenses of the memorial service, a festive meal, and distributions to the poor. It should be noted that these commemorative services were especially important for Maria, who was childless and could not count on her descendants to arrange these memorial liturgies. One noteworthy aspect of the relationship between Maria and the Aviron Monastery was that her husband had requested that she be buried at Aviron alongside him, an inconceivable possibility on a holy mountain which excluded women even in death. Maria herself did not follow up at her husband's wish, instead leaving instructions that she was to be buried wherever she happened to be at the time of her death. The spiritual connections of some female donors to Athenite monasteries were so close that a few of them even termed themselves brethren of the monastery. When a woman called Maria and her husband Constantine gave property to the Great Lavra, Maria wrote as follows in the act of donation, and I quote, "During our entire life, we have been devoted to the Lavra and have much faith in it. Therefore, since we have now reached old age and have no son or anyone else to take care of our souls, we have sought refuge at the Holy Lavra as at a harbor of salvation, so that the monks may inscribe our names in the holy diptychs of the church to be commemorated at the Holy Liturgy in atonement for our sins. From now on, we will be united with the monks in spirit, having become one soul with them, and being brethren of the Lavra, since it is our mother from now on, and we are her children," end quote. Although she was physically separated from Athos, Maria viewed the abbot as her spiritual father, the Lavra as her mother, and herself as one of the brethren and children of the Lavra. In addition to immovable properties such as fields, vineyards, and olive groves, women also made donations to Athenite monasteries of small portable objects such as icons, liturgical vessels, manuscripts, and works of minor art, including crosses and other objects and precious metals. In her will, Kallipa Kuriani stipulated that the following items were to be sent to Eviron, the burial site of her husband: 2 icons with silver frames, one of Christ and one of the Virgin, a silver cross, and 2 silver lampstands. These were intended to adorn her husband's tomb and were given, quote, "on account of my great love for Athos," end quote. Another monastery, Vatopedi, was to receive 2 other icons, one of the deesis, one of the baptism of Christ, and some liturgical books from her private chapel. We can get some idea of the nature of these gifts of a wealthy aristocratic woman from some similar objects from the late Byzantine period that are still preserved on Athos today. First, let me show you an icon now at the Vatopedi Monastery, the Virgin who is the hope of those in despair. It was commissioned in the 14th century by a woman called Anna Philanthropini for the Convent of Good Hope in Constantinople, and at an unknown date ended up at Vatopedi. Thus, it was not originally a donation to Athos, but it is exactly the type of icon that a wealthy woman might have possessed and left as a legacy to a monastery. This cross, sheathed in silver gilt, was given by the wife of the Emperor Manuel II Palaiologos, Helena, to the Dionysiou Monastery in the 15th century, and its inscription describes it as a votive offering. One can also find in the libraries of Athos a number of important manuscripts presented by female donors. In the early 14th century, Irene, probably Yolanda of Montferrat, the second wife of Emperor Andronicus II, gave the Lavra a lectionary of very large format and requested the prayers of the monks who read from the beautifully illuminated volume that included this beautiful evangelist portrait and elaborate headpieces. In the mid-14th century, another empress, Anna of Savoy, mother of John V Palaiologos, commissioned the manufacture of a psalter in the most famous scriptorium in Constantinople, that of the Odigon Monastery. It was destined for Eviron and was intended as a thank offering to the monastery on behalf of Anna and her son. It also was distinguished by elaborate headpieces. And so to conclude, although Byzantine women were not able to visit the monasteries of Mount Athos in person, many of them formed spiritual relationships with these institutions through pious donations, often termed psychika, or gifts of the soul. In return for their generous offerings, they might receive bodily sustenance, such as food provisions for their remaining years, or have their names inscribed in the so-called diptychs of the church, which recorded the names of those supporters of the monastery for whom prayers or liturgy were to be said during their lifetimes and on the anniversary of their deaths. For major donors, the rewards were even greater, even though it was impossible, as we have seen, for Kali Maria Pakuriani to be buried alongside her husband at Iviron, as was his wish. The couple was honored as founders of the monastery, and on the anniversary of their deaths, all the abbots of Athos were invited to Iviron for the memorial service and banquet. Thank you for your attention.
Well, good evening, and thank you very much for your kind welcome and hospitality. I think it would be fair to say that our marriage has been sustained by Greek hospitality from the time of our honeymoon on Paxos through many, many visits to Greece. And also, my ministry as an Anglican priest has certainly been mightily supported by Orthodox theology and friendship, and have had the privilege of going to Mount Athos as a pilgrim for the last dozen years or so. So why should an Anglican priest make a regular pilgrimage to Mount Athos each year in Lent? Well, partly because in Anglican tradition, an annual retreat is an expected part of a priest's life and ministry, indispensable in my experience. But also because the renewal of Mount Athos in our time is of the utmost spiritual significance for the whole Christian church. Indeed, its renewal has to be seen in a wider context, the widespread renewal of monastic life across Greece. For example, the large women's monastery at Ormelia in Halkidiki, which is an outpost of Simonas Petra. We could also place the renewal of Mount Athos in the context of the renewal of monastic life more widely in Russia, Egypt, America, and in parts of Europe. In these monasteries today, young and well-educated young people and others commit their lives to the service and worship of God, and in this they have wide support from among the laity from whom they come. There is another reason for taking a keen and encouraging interest in Mount Athos. It is important that its life and witness is properly understood and appreciated in the West. This is one of the reasons for the work of the Friends of Mount Athos. And visiting Mount Athos certainly leads to many interesting encounters with Christians from across southeastern Europe and from Russia, Ukraine, as elsewhere. Simonas Petra also has close links with Christians in Syria and Lebanon. The economic suffering of these regions is known, of course, but not always well known and understood in the West. And the pastoral work of these monasteries on Athos and across Greece is now of decisive importance to many people who are enduring the austerity and poverty caused by the current ongoing economic crisis. Finally, I think it's important that Athonite monks sense the support and prayers of Western Christians. The presence of Russian influence on the Holy Mountain is strong and can be overbearing, and it has caused difficulties in the past. Mount Athos is a truly ecumenical environment, and this breadth of spirit needs to be sustained and encouraged. I normally go to the Holy Mountain at the end of March, in a spring is just beginning. And the centrality of the presence of Christ, whose name is being invoked so sincerely and sensitively, is the first thing that always strikes me when I share in an Athonite service. The private recitation of the Jesus Prayer is the hidden counterpoint to the corporate chanting of the divine offices. It is also the hidden bond of love between all the participants during the long hours of worship. I use the word sensitivity deliberately, because that is what often comes across from individual monks. Their kindness and generosity of spirit springs from their sensitivity to the presence of Christ in their guests. This is the true grace of monastic life, Eastern and Western, for as St. Benedict said in his rule, let a guest be welcomed as if he were Christ himself. The ability of these great monasteries to make a stranger from another part of the Christian church so welcome and at home over so many years is a gracious gift and witness indeed. I remember, for example, strongly, the overwhelming sense of the presence of Christ in the pre-sanctified gifts at a solemn Lenten celebration at Simonas Petra, even though as an Anglican priest, I was not an active recipient. Now, by training and temperament, I'm a church historian, and I've been fortunate to have had the time and opportunity to study deeply and to travel widely in Europe and elsewhere, including visits to many monasteries. And the historical significance of the Holy Mountain is, of course, immense, as Graham Speake has demonstrated in his two masterly studies. And to be plunged into the rich treasury of Vatopedi, for example, is a unique experience, as it is to worship there in the church that is 1,000 years old, complete with so many of its original decorations. The monastic tradition is one of the most abiding threads that unite the church across the century. And the renewal of Mount Athos, and for that matter of monasteries in Egypt and Russia as well, is a striking sign of this spiritual reality, as well as a rebuff to the apparently inexorable progress of Western secularism. What is palpable while being a pilgrim on the Holy Mountain is the transformation of the sense of time. It is not just that the past is so manifestly the foundation of the present there. It is that time is revealed in its proper perspective as the narthex of eternity. Time spent on Athos is an engagement with the inner structure of reality. It is this that changes people, probably for the most part quite unselfconsciously. The phrase from the Western Apostles' Creed, Communio Sanctorum, takes on its full and original meaning, the communion of holy people, of holy places, of holy things, within the koinonia, or communion, that flows from the inner life of God, the Trinity. The great silence of Athos, as well as its beauty, establishes a true sense of the words with which the Bible opens and closes. God saw that it was very good, and behold, I am making all things new. This transformation of vision is an abiding one because it steals up unawares, and all that is required of the pilgrim is a clear mind and an open and prayerful heart.
I should like to speak now about the purpose of monasticism, whether on Athos or elsewhere. What is the monk here for? What is his essential task? And what service does the monk render to the Christian community or the world at large? Let me start with a modern answer by a Finnish Orthodox writer, Tito Colliander, but his words apply to Athos. A monk was once asked, "What do you do there in the monastery?" He replied, "We fall and get up, fall and get up, fall and get up again." There you have the idea that the monastery is a place of continual repentance, of constant conversion. And that is not just a modern answer, but it is an ancient answer as well. We find it, for example, in a key text, the Gerontikon, or Sayings of the Desert Fathers, a text which is held in honor on Athos as elsewhere. For example, one of the Desert Fathers is asked by his disciple why he sits alone in his cell and weeps. And he answers, I am weeping for my sins. St. Anthony, pioneer in the monastic life, says, this is a person's chief work, always to blame himself for his sins in God's sight. In Syriac, the term for a monk is a mourner. So the monk, looked at by himself, is the sinner, the poor man, defined not by what he does for others, but by his own need. A person comes to the monastery not because he makes any claim to transform society around him, but because he feels himself to be a sinner and is seeking salvation. St. Isaac of Nineveh, writing in the 7th century, is one who says, a monk is one who spends all the days of his life in hunger, thirst, and mourning for the sake of the expectation of the heavenly hope. That is a rather somber answer, what is the monk doing? And it may seem to be also a selfish answer. Does the monk care only about his own salvation without thought for the other members of the Christian family? So what services do the monasteries render to society, whether in Athos or elsewhere? A first feature that the monasteries perform, not very frequently but sometimes, is evangelism. Some of the Athonite monks have gone out to preach the Christian faith, to go round as missionaries. One outstanding example of this is in the 18th century, St. Cosmas the Aetolian, who was a monk of Philotheu on the Holy Mountain. And he went out on a series of missionary journeys round northern Greece at a time when the Christian community as a whole was at a low ebb. But most monks do not expect to leave Athos in order to go and preach the faith. They would expect to stay there for life. So we might say, secondly, do the monks of Athos contribute to scholarship? We can recall how in the West, in the early Middle Ages, the Benedictine monasteries were largely responsible for preserving Christian civilization. But the Athonite monasteries have not been called to fulfill that kind of role, because in the Byzantine era and afterwards, there was always a tradition of lay scholarship, particularly among members of the civil service. Here is what is said by a contemporary Athonite monk, Father Diokleia, of the monastery of Dionysiou. In the Eastern Church, the existence of the scholar monk is quite unknown. The monk finds no justification except as a worker of virtue, as a contemplative soul called by God. The cell of the monk is not a room for scholarly research and writing, but a place for prayer, work, meditation, and the tempering of the soul for special spiritual struggles in an unworldly, solitary, and quiet region. Perhaps Father Theoclitus rather overstates the point here, for there have been Athonite monks whose writings have had a profound influence on the life of the church at large. A notable example, again from the 18th century, is Saint Nicodemus of the Holy Mountain, the editor of the Philokalia. And the Philokalia has had an unparalleled influence in orthodoxy over the last 200 years and is still a source of spiritual life to a very vivid extent. I suppose Saint Nicodemus was not exclusively a scholar, but he certainly devoted his life to writing and editing. But that would not be true of all the monks of Athos. We might ask, in the third place, are the monasteries there on Athos or elsewhere to provide social and philanthropic and charitable work, service to the poor? The answer is that Orthodox monasticism in general has certainly done a great deal in the way of charitable work. Here are the words of a great Byzantinist, Norman Baines. One of the outstanding features of early Byzantine asceticism is its passion for social justice and its championship of the poor and oppressed. It has sometimes been said that the ascetic ideal of the East Roman was a barren withdrawal from the world of his day. In reality, the Byzantine, in his hour of need, turned instinctively for aid and comfort to the ascetic in the full assurance of his sympathy and succor. In general, we find frequent examples of monasteries running hospitals, old people's homes, almshouses for the poor and destitute, lodgings for travelers, orphanages, relief work for refugees. But that would be mainly the case with monasteries close to cities. Naturally, it does not apply to the same extent to Athos, which is distant from the larger centers of civilization. But in certain cases, the Athenite monks have performed social work. For example, the monastery of Iveron used to run a house just outside the main monastery for lepers. I don't think that exists today anymore, but it is an example of direct social service. But perhaps a fourth feature is an important example of what the monasteries do for others. And that's been already mentioned by the last speaker, hospitality. The monasteries are places to which pilgrims can come, where they can remain for a shorter or longer time, sharing in the prayer of the monks. As our last speaker said, St. Benedict in the West insists in his rule that the guest is to be received as if he were Christ himself. And that would also be the attitude of Athenite monasteries. I remember talking once with the abbot of the monastery of Dionysiou, Father Gabriel, who held office for some 50 years. And he said, many of the monks regard visitors as a distraction and an annoyance. This is quite wrong. The reception of pilgrims, the providing of hospitality, said Father Gabriel, is an essential part of our monastic vocation. And he continued that as regards the money that comes into the monastery, this he divided into three parts. The first part would be used for the upkeep of the buildings, often old and very expensive. The second part of any income to the monastery, he said, would go towards the needs of the monks. But the third part would be devoted, one third of all the resources of the monastery, to entertaining pilgrims. So that is an essential task for the monk. The problem today is that many of those who come to the Holy Mountain do not come as pilgrims, but as tourists.